Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Darkest Winter by William W. Johnstone and J.A. Johnstone. Narrated by Cody Roberts. The moving finger writes, and, having writ, moves on. Nor all thy piety nor wit shall lure it back to cancel half a line, nor all thy tears wash out a word of it. The Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam, translated by Edward Fitzgerald. Chapter 1. Breckenridge Wallace had no doubt that the men following him intended to rob him. Probably planned on killing him to boot. Breck figured he'd have something to say about that. A cloudy day had given way to a starless night, so the darkness was thick around Breckenridge as he walked along a St. Louis street toward Red Mike's Tavern. Enough of a chill lingered from the recently departed winter to make the air dank this close to the river. The Mississippi lay like a giant serpent gliding past the settlement. Breckenridge walked through a small patch of light that spilled from a window in one of the buildings he passed. That brief illumination revealed a giant of a man in buckskins, tall, broad-shouldered, heavy with muscle. His face, too rugged to be called handsome, was clean-shaven. A wide-brimmed, gray felt hat was shoved down on unruly, shaggy red hair that hung almost to those brawny shoulders. Breck carried a long-barreled flintlock rifle in his left hand. A pair of flintlock pistols were shoved behind the broad leather belt strapped around his waist, as well as a bone-handled, wickedly keen hunting knife in a fringed leather scabbard. Even a glimpse was enough to confirm that he was a dangerous man. Tonight he was even more dangerous than usual, because he felt like he had nothing left to lose and just didn't give a damn. He slowed as he passed the light and entered an even thicker patch of shadow, willing the three men behind him to go ahead and catch up. He wanted them to make their move. Whatever happened might prove to be a welcome distraction. His keen ears picked up the faint scuff of boot leather on cobblestones from the darkness ahead of him. A grim smile tugged at the corners of Breckenridge's wide mouth. The would-be robbers were smarter than he had taken them for at first. One of them had circled around through the alleys and gotten ahead of him. Either that, or they'd had a Confederate laying an ambush for him all along. Three enemies or four, it didn't really matter. Breckenridge didn't care either way. He strode on, to all appearances completely unaware of the threat. Then he heard a grunt of effort, along with a whisper of sound as something swung through the air, likely a club aimed at his head. He took a quick step to the side and felt the bludgeon brush against the buckskin sleeve on his upper left arm. He dropped the rifle and reached out blindly as the missed blow made his attacker stumble. Breckenridge's big hands closed over the man's shoulders. His long legs drove them toward the wall of a building that was only a few swift steps away. Breck rammed the man against it with such force that his skull shattered. He heard the soggy thud, like a dropped gourd. Rapid footsteps sounded as Breckenridge let go of the man and stepped back, turning to meet the new threat.
"Get him," a harsh voice grated. "Kill the son of a bitch."
That was plenty to tell Breckenridge his hunch was right. He didn't have to hold back, which was good since he'd already killed a man. He drew both pistols from behind his belt. The weapons were loaded and primed, so all Breck had to do was loop his thumbs around the hammers and pull them back. Then he squeezed the triggers, and twin deafening booms filled the street as the guns went off. Flame shot nearly a foot from the muzzle of each pistol. In that split-second glare, Breckenridge saw one of the heavy lead balls from the right-hand gun tear into the throat of a man charging him. The pistols were double-shotted. The second ball punched into the man's chest. His momentum carried him forward as blood spurted from both wounds. Breckenridge had aimed at the sound of footsteps, and his accuracy with the left-hand pistol wasn't quite as good. One of the balls missed entirely and skipped off down the street. The other struck the man in the right shoulder, shredding flesh and smashing bone. The impact twisted him halfway around and caused him to stumble. He crashed to the street, hurt badly enough that Breck knew he was out of the fight. In a matter of a dozen heartbeats, three of the four men who had intended to rob and kill him were down and no longer a threat. That left only one man, who had been slightly behind the two Breckenridge had just shot. Most thieves would have turned and run, since the odds were no longer on their side. But not this one. He let out a furious yell as he continued his charge. Breckenridge saw a glint of light reflect off a blade as it sliced through the air at his face. He flung up his left hand. The empty pistol it held clashed with the knife. Metal rang against metal. Breck took a quick step back, knowing the attacker would try to catch him on the backswing. For a split second, the man was silhouetted against the patch of light Breck had walked through a minute earlier. The bastard didn't have a knife, Breckenridge realized during that glimpse. He had a damn sword. Probably a former soldier, an officer judging by the fact he had a saber. Or maybe just a thief who'd taken the weapon off the body of some victim. That was the more likely explanation. Either way, Breckenridge had to keep retreating as the varmint lunged at him, whipping the long, slightly curved blade back and forth. Then Breckenridge's foot came down on the barrel of the rifle he had dropped. That was enough to throw him off balance. He tried to right himself, but the rough cobblestones tripped him, and he fell over backward. The attacker leaped in to take advantage of Breckenridge's bad luck. The saber swung high and then flashed down. Breck still had hold of both pistols. He crossed the barrels and shoved them up. The V formed by the pistols caught the saber and stopped it with its edge scant inches from Breck's face. Breckenridge swung his right leg high in a kick aimed at the man's groin. It missed, but the toe of his boot sunk into the attacker's belly instead, which was almost as effective. The breath woofed out of the man's lungs as he doubled over. Breck lashed out with his left leg and swept the man's feet from under him. The thief tumbled to the ground. Breckenridge dropped the empty pistols and yanked his knife from its sheath. He rolled onto his side, powered halfway up, and leaped at the other man, who seemed momentarily stunned. The varmint managed to angle the saber around in a protective arc. In the poor light, Breckenridge caught sight of it just in time to twist aside. The blade raked across the top of his left shoulder, but cut only the buckskin without slicing into the flesh beneath. Breck hooked his knife toward the man's midsection, aiming to rip his guts open. Instead, the man got out of the way somehow, and the knife scraped hard against one of the cobblestones and tore itself out of Breck's grip. Unarmed now, he didn't take the time to feel around for the knife. Instinct guided him as he grabbed his attacker's right wrist with his left hand. That allowed him to hold the sword off while he sought for the man's throat with his other hand. As they rolled and wrestled in the street, Breckenridge could tell that the other man was big and muscular as well. It would take daylight to determine which of the two combatants was larger. All that mattered on this dark night was that they were evenly matched. The first one to slip or make a slight mistake would probably die in the next instant. Something unexpected altered the balance of power. Breckenridge heaved himself up, looming over his opponent for a second. As he did, a heavy blow slammed down on his back.
"Hold him, Gordy!" a man shouted. "I'll bash his brains out!"
The thief Breckenridge had shot in the shoulder must have overcome the pain and loss of blood enough to find the dropped club and get back in the fight. That surprised Breck. He had figured the man would bleed to death or at least pass out. As it was, he now had two of the bastards to deal with. Hearing the wounded man scrambling to get in position for another blow, Breckenridge let go of the man with the sword and rolled aside. The man with the club grunted as it swept down and hit the cobblestones. Breck could make out the man's dim shape. He kicked the fellow in the chest and sent him sprawling backward. The club clattered away. The man tried to get up, then sighed and fell back, his injury finally catching up with him. Breckenridge leaped to his feet. He heard someone running away. The man with the saber had given up and decided it was best to escape while he could. The better part of valor, someone had called it once, Breck recalled. To him, it was just turning tail, something he would never do. But actually, he had done exactly that, one time not that long ago. The thought stabbed into him sharper than any saber ever could. He shoved it away and took stock. He was barely breathing hard, even after all the desperate exertion. His big hand slapped over his body. No blood. He hadn't thought he'd been stabbed or cut, but it was good to make sure. Sometimes a man could be hurt and not feel it in the heat of battle. A low groan came from somewhere not far off. That would be the wounded man. Breckenridge listened, heard a faint rattle. A death rattle. Loss of blood had finally done the bastard in. So he was standing in the street with three dead men, Breckenridge thought. So far, no one had come to investigate the gunshots. But a constable might show up sooner or later. This close to the waterfront, the authorities in St. Louis expected violence. The men who worked the riverboats were a hardy, proddy breed. So were the fur trappers and mountain men who used the settlement as the jumping-off point for their expeditions to the Rocky Mountains. Bloody clashes were inevitable. Despite that, there had to be some semblance of law and order, Breckenridge knew. This was just about the farthest western outpost of civilization. But the folks who lived here still considered it civilized and would tolerate only so many corpses in the streets. It would be better, Breck thought, if he wasn't anywhere around when these particular carcasses were found. Besides, the letter he had gotten from his friend Morgan Baxter said that Morgan would be waiting for him every evening in Red Mike's until he showed up. So Breckenridge searched in the street until he found his rifle, his knife, and the two pistols, then turned his steps in that direction again. Chapter 2. Red Mike's was one of the most notorious taverns in a settlement known for them. Its big, red-headed, hard-fisted Irish proprietor kept trouble from breaking out most of the time. But whenever a brawl did erupt, it was always a spectacular, furniture-shattering, blood-spilling brouhaha. Other ruckuses went on in the street and alleys just outside the tavern night and day. Mountain men gravitated toward the place, and so did riverboaters. That was a recipe for trouble, often with booming guns and the flash of blades. Tonight, however, the tavern was so blamed peaceful that Mike had to stifle a yawn as he stood behind the bar. He straightened from his casual pose, though, when he saw the big fella come in. He recognized Breckenridge Wallace, of course. It was impossible to miss somebody that tall and massive. The hair on Breck's head was a distinctive flaming red, brighter than Mike's own shaggy, rust-colored thatch. Breck looked a little disheveled tonight, as if he'd recently run into trouble. It would be a lot more surprising if Breckenridge Wallace hadn't gotten into a scrape. The youngster attracted folks trying to kill him like a lodestone drew iron filings. Maybe this would liven up the evening, Mike thought. He just hoped the tavern would still be standing when Breckenridge left. Red Mike wasn't the only one who immediately took note of Breckenridge's entrance. At one of the tables in a rear corner, a young man in high-topped boots, whipcord trousers, and a corduroy jacket over a woolen shirt stood up and lifted a hand to catch Breck's attention. A grin stretched across his face. Brown-haired and well-built, although he would appear small next to Breck, he was the big redhead's best friend and trapping partner, Morgan Baxter. Breckenridge spotted Morgan and started through the room toward the table. He ignored the glances of recognition, and sometimes resentment and dislike, directed at him by the tavern's other patrons. Breckenridge had made some enemies in the past, but he didn't waste time worrying about that. No sense in dwelling on what had already happened, when he never had to wait long for some new problem to crop up right in front of him. Trouble had dogged Breckenridge's trail for a couple of years now. He had grown to manhood on a farm near Knoxville, Tennessee, in the shadow of the Blue Ridge Mountains, where he had spent most of his time hunting and fishing, to the great annoyance of his pa, who figured Breck should be plowing and planting instead. Things might have continued like that indefinitely, if Breckenridge hadn't fallen in love with the wrong woman. That had led to violence and tragedy, and forced Breck to leave home as a fugitive. He had headed west, thinking that he might like to see the Rockies. But along the way, he had encountered plenty more danger. He had made some friends, though, the best of whom was Morgan Baxter. An Easterner from a wealthy family, Morgan had put that behind him to live the life of a fur trapper, in partnership with Breck. A threat from Breckenridge's past had followed him west, though, and another beautiful woman had complicated things even more. Breck figured on marrying her, but first he had to return home to settle things at last with an old enemy. He had taken his intended bride with him so she could meet his family. The plan was that they would rendezvous with Morgan in St. Louis in the spring, and then head up the Missouri River again, bound for the bright and shining mountains that Breck now considered his true home. Morgan came out from behind the table to throw his arms around Breckenridge and repeatedly slap his old friend on the back. "Damn it, you big galoot," he said. "If you're not a sight for sore eyes, I sort of expected you before now." Breckenridge pounded Morgan on the back too, then had to catch him to keep him from being knocked to the floor by the exuberant greeting. Breck took hold of Morgan's shoulders and set him upright, then said, "I ran into a little fracas on the way here tonight." "Well, that doesn't surprise me, but I didn't mean tonight in particular. I just thought you and Dulcie might reach St. Louis before now." Morgan frowned slightly and leaned to the side to peer around Breckenridge's looming form. "Where is Dulcie? Did you leave her at a hotel or a boarding house? I wouldn't blame you. Red Mike's is hardly the sort of place you'd want to bring a woman you plan on marrying." The grin that had appeared on Breckenridge's rugged face as he and Morgan exchanged greetings vanished in an instant. "She ain't with me," he said. Morgan's frown deepened. "What? She's all right, isn't she? That bullet wound she got?" Breckenridge shook his head. "That healed up just fine. Last time I saw her, she was hale and hearty. It's just that her and me, well, we ain't getting married after all."
"Not getting married? Breck, what the hell? You love that girl, and I'm pretty sure she loves you too."
"Maybe so,
but that ain't all there is to it.
Breckenridge pulled out one of the chairs at the table.
I don't plan on talking about it, Morgan, and I'd sure appreciate it if we could just leave things at that.
Well, sure, Breck. Morgan was visibly flustered, but he shook his head and went on. We're partners, and if that's the way you want it, that's the way it'll be.
He went back to his chair. We're still heading for the mountains, though, aren't we?
Darned right we are. You got an outfit put together for us?
I sure do. 2 fine canoes that we can bring back down the river in the fall, stacked high with pelts. I have plenty of supplies for us, too.
Breckenridge sat down and reached for the jug that sat on the table.
I sure appreciate you doing all that. I reckon you probably had to pay more than your fair share for all of it, since I didn't have a whole heap of money to leave with you when I headed back to Tennessee.
Morgan waved a hand and said, Don't worry about that. The money I inherited from my father would last us a long time, even if we weren't making more trapping. But we had a decent season last year, and I'm sure this season will be even better. If we keep it up, you'll be a rich man one of these days, Breck.
Breckenridge shook his head. I don't care a lick about being rich. I never seen anything to make me think a lot of money really makes folks happy. I just want to get back to the high country, breathe some of that air, and see an eagle soaring way up in that blue sky, free as he can be.
He tipped the jug to his mouth and took a long swallow of the fiery liquor it held. The whiskey kindled a small fire in his belly, but other than that, he didn't feel any effect from it. With his size, he could drink all night and not get drunk. Morgan picked up the jug when Breckenridge slid it back across the table to him.
To the high country, he said.
He downed a slug of the liquor too, coughed a little, and wiped the back of his hand across his mouth.
When do you want to get started?
The sooner the better,
Breckenridge said. The next morning, Breckenridge sold the horse he had ridden to St. Louis to the livery where he had stabled the animal. Morgan had rented some space in a shed-like warehouse near the waterfront for the canoes and supplies. He and Breck carried the sturdy but lightweight craft to the river, one at a time, and tied them to one of the docks. Then they went back to fetch the supplies and toted them to the canoes. Sugar, flour, salt, coffee, and salted pork were the staples they were taking with them. They also had some tobacco, although Breck didn't use the stuff, and Morgan puffed on a pipe only occasionally. It was good for trading with friendly Indians, though. They also had a few bolts of cloth and some assorted knick-knacks and gewgaws to use as trade goods. Many of the tribes were hostile to the white trappers coming into what they considered their lands. But often such wrath could be turned aside by something shiny or colorful. And for the times when that didn't turn out to be the case, Breckenridge and Morgan were taking along plenty of powder and shot, too. The previous summer they'd had a couple of partners, but this year it would be just the two of them. They wouldn't be able to take as many pelts that way, but they would have to split the profits only 2 ways. Breckenridge intended to see to it that Morgan recouped every bit of his investment before they started divvying up the rest of the money. Morgan would probably argue about that, but Breck intended to stand firm. Morgan hadn't mentioned Dulcie again. Breckenridge was thankful for that. He didn't want to dwell on what had happened between them, and it would be easier to put the whole thing behind him if he didn't have to go around explaining it. He wanted to look forward instead of back. As always, the riverfront was a busy place this morning. Dozens of steamboats were tied up at the wharves that stretched for more than a mile along the western bank. Scores of burly dock workers loaded the boats with cargo to be carried back downriver to New Orleans. Later in the day, northbound vessels would be arriving, and they would be heavily laden with cargo that had to be unloaded. Breckenridge watched the men, a mixture of white, black, and even a few Indians, struggling with the crates and was glad he didn't have to work at a job like that. The labor wouldn't bother him much. He was big and strong and could carry heavy loads all day without getting too tired. But being stuck there, going back and forth between the wharves and the decks of the riverboats all day, would drive him mad. Going back and forth, plowing the rows in a field, had affected him the same way. Something inside him had to be up and moving, but he wanted to actually get somewhere. He and Morgan weren't the only ones preparing to head for the mountains. About 50 yards up the riverfront, a group of men in buckskins and homespun were loading supplies onto half a dozen canoes. Some wore felt hats like Breckenridge and Morgan, while others sported coonskin caps or knit toques like northern backwoodsmen Breck had met in the Rockies. They were armed to the teeth with rifles, pistols, knives, and tomahawks. Trapping was dangerous work. A man with a bushy black beard extending halfway down his chest seemed to be the leader. He wasn't very tall and gave the appearance of being almost as wide as he was high. None of his bulk appeared to be fat, though. Thick slabs of muscle coated his arms, shoulders, chest, and back, and bulged against the tight buckskin shirt he wore. His stubby legs were as big around as tree trunks. When he'd skinned the raccoon to make the cap he wore, he had left the creature's head on, so its snout pointed the same way as the bearded man's face was turned, and its dead eyes peered the same direction as its owner's deep-set, beady ones. A steady stream of shouted orders and profanities made its way past the huge chaw of tobacco that distended the man's cheek. His voice was deep and powerful enough to carry up and down the riverfront, over the normal hubbub. Breckenridge looked at the bearded man and asked Morgan,
"Who's that big bag of wind over yonder? I don't recollect seeing him last year."
"I think his name's Carnahan. I've heard a few men mention him. He's supposed to be quite the ring-tailed roarer."
Morgan chuckled.
"If you don't believe me, you can ask him. I'm sure he'd be happy to tell you."
"No, that's all right. I've never been that comfortable around fellas who like to beat their own drum. That's a pretty rough-looking bunch he's got with him."
"They look like cutthroats and brigands to me. I'd just as soon not run into them, once we're out there hundreds of miles from anywhere."
Breckenridge's broad shoulders rose and fell in a shrug.
"I never worried over much about such things. They leave me alone, and I'll leave them alone. That's the way I'd like it, too."
Carnahan, if that was actually the bearded man's name, had climbed into one of the canoes, which were larger than the ones Breckenridge and Morgan were using. Each held 3 men, except a lone canoe with only 2 occupants. A man came hurrying along the dock at the last minute and climbed into that canoe, filling out its complement. Carnahan yelled something at him, causing him to turn half around and lift a hand in acknowledgement of what sounded like a reprimand, although Breckenridge couldn't make out the words this time. Breckenridge frowned at the sight of the newcomer. The man was dressed in black and had an old-fashioned tricorn hat on his head. His craggy, lantern-jawed face was made even more striking by the black patch over his left eye. There was something else about him that had really caught Breck's attention, though, and he pondered it as he watched the men begin to paddle, sending the canoes arrowing out into the broad, sluggish stream. The latecomer wore a scabbarded saber that had bounced against his thigh as he hurried along the dock.
Chapter 3.
Breckenridge had no way of knowing if the man who had joined Carnahan's party at the last minute was the same one who had attacked him the previous night. Certainly, it was possible that more than one man in St. Louis carried a saber. The man with the eye patch, though, looked like somebody who had tried to rob and kill a stranger, and Morgan had said that Carnahan's men were cutthroats. If the situation had been different, Breckenridge might have confronted the man and tried to find out the truth, just to satisfy his own curiosity, if for no other reason. But if his hunch was right, such a confrontation might have afforded him the opportunity to finish that fight, and he would have welcomed that. The other canoes were well out of sight by the time Breckenridge and Morgan pushed off from the dock. Better to just forget about it, Breck told himself. Anyway, they were all headed in the same direction. They were liable to encounter each other somewhere out there on the frontier. Breckenridge didn't think it was very likely he would forget a fella who looked like that and carried a sword. For the moment, he was content to be out on the great river, the muscles in his arms and shoulders working smoothly as he stroked with the paddle he held. Switching from side to side with each stroke, he propelled the canoe against the current. Its sharply pointed prow cleaved the muddy water and sent it bubbling and splashing past the craft. A few yards to Breckenridge's right and slightly behind, Morgan paddled his canoe. Time meant little in a situation like this. The hours drifted past, much like the landscape on both sides of the river. By mid-morning, Breckenridge and Morgan had made the turn into the Missouri River, where the Big Muddy flowed into the Father of Waters. The banks on both sides of the broad stream were low and covered with trees and brush. Away from the river, the terrain rolled away endlessly in gentle hills. This was the heartland of the continent, and it beat in a slow, steady rhythm, just like the paddles wielded by the two men dipped into the water and propelled them onward. Now and then they put into shore and stopped to rest. Breckenridge didn't need the respite so much, but Morgan did. The months he had spent on the frontier had toughened him, especially compared to his previous soft existence back east. But he still didn't possess Breck's almost supernatural strength and stamina, and never would. During one of those breaks, Breckenridge could tell that Morgan wanted to ask him about Dulcie. Morgan frowned, started several times to say something inconsequential without finishing, and seemed generally uncomfortable. Breckenridge didn't want to talk about it, though. So after a few minutes, he went to his canoe and got ready to shove it back into the water.
"Let's get going," he said. "Them beaver ain't gonna trap and skin themselves."
"That's true," Morgan said. He seemed almost relieved that he hadn't forced the issue. As they paddled back out into the river, Breckenridge hoped Morgan would just put the past completely out of his thoughts. That's what he was trying to do. They camped that night in what seemed like a vast, dark emptiness. Breckenridge knew that in another day or so, they would start seeing Indian villages along the river. Other trappers would be making their way toward the mountains too. But on this night, no other campfires were in sight. Breckenridge was a mite wary of kindling one himself, but Morgan wanted hot food and coffee. Anyway, they hadn't come very far from St. Louis. There shouldn't be any real danger along this stretch of the river. He kept his rifle close at hand regardless. The pistols behind his belt were loaded and ready to belch fire and leaden death. Breckenridge's blue eyes narrowed in concentration and searched the darkness intently every time he heard the faintest sound. A man could grow weary of being so cautious all the time, he thought. But if he ever let his guard down, sure enough, that would be the time when he needed to be most alert. The prospect of death didn't bother him, as long as he could go out fighting, as he knew he was meant to. But to be taken by surprise was unacceptable. The night passed without incident, and the two canoes were back on the river when the sun came up the next morning. 2 more days went by in much the same fashion. On the 4th day after leaving St. Louis, Breckenridge spotted a tendril of gray smoke rising into the sky ahead of them, and pointed it out to Morgan.
Engine camp, he called across the water. I always, most likely. You remember, we spent a night with one band of them last fall, somewhere upriver.
That's right, Morgan replied. Are we going to stop again?
Breckenridge thought his friend sounded hopeful that they would stop and visit with the Indians. 3 days of not seeing anyone else probably had Morgan a little restless. He was a fellow who genuinely liked being around people. For the most part, Breck could take him or leave him.
We'll put in and visit for a spell, he said. The Iowas are friendly folks. As I recollect, they moved around a lot. Every time the whites start crowding in where they live, they up and move instead of fighting. One of these days they're liable to have to do the same thing here.
Do you really think civilization will expand past St. Louis? I had the idea that that might be the end of it, despite any talk about manifest destiny.
Breckenridge shook his head.
Reckon it's only a matter of time. One of these days, there'll be people shoving in all over the dang country, until there won't be room for a fella to spit. I'm just glad I probably won't live to see it.
They came within sight of 24 earthen lodges scattered on the left-hand bank of the river. The Iowa were horse Indians who did a certain amount of wandering and hunting. But they built semi-permanent villages like this one, too, where some of them lived year-round and planted crops. When they were on the move, they lived in buffalo hide teepees like their cousins farther west. In the villages, they dwelled in these mound-like lodges made of mud and brush. As Breckenridge and Morgan angled their canoes toward the shore, dogs gathered and began to bark at them. The commotion drew a large number of the Indians, who stood watching the two white men paddle closer. Most of the men had feathers sticking up at angles from their greased topknots. Colorful blankets were draped around their shoulders over their buckskins. The women, squat and round-faced, chattered among themselves. Excited children whooped and hollered. Added to the dogs barking, it made for quite a racket. When the water was shallow enough, Breckenridge and Morgan stepped out of the canoes and dragged the craft halfway up onto the shore. Breck lifted his right hand, palm out, and said,
"Howdy, folks."
This was a different village from the one where he and Morgan had stopped the previous fall. He didn't see anyone he recognized. He wondered if any of the Iowas spoke the white man's tongue. That question was put to rest quickly by an older man who stepped forward and said in good English,
"Welcome to our home, my friends. I am Mahuska, the chief of these people."
"Breckenridge Wallace," Breck introduced himself. "This is Morgan Baxter."
Morgan nodded and said,
"I'm mighty pleased to meet you, chief."
Breckenridge heard some giggles coming from the young women of the tribe. He knew they were looking at Morgan and whispering to each other about him. Gals always seemed to think he was a right handsome fella. Most females didn't react the same way to him, other than his red hair and blue eyes. He bore a distinct resemblance to a grizzly bear, or at least he figured that was so.
"You are on your way to the Shining Mountains?"
Mahuska asked.
"That's right," Breckenridge said. "We're fur trappers and traders."
The chief still looked solemn, but Breckenridge thought he saw amusement twinkling in the man's dark eyes.
"What will you do when the beaver are gone?"
"Oh, that day won't ever come," Morgan said. "There are millions and millions of them up in the mountains."
"There is an end to everything," Mahuska said. "But come, visit with us. We will smoke and eat and talk."
The crowd parted when Mahuska turned and walked toward the largest of the lodges, accompanied by the rest of the older men and several young, brawnier warriors. Breckenridge and Morgan fell in with them. Some of the women reached out and poked fingers against Breckenridge and Morgan as they walked by, then laughed. Breck grinned back at them. He knew they didn't mean any harm. A friendly bunch, Morgan commented quietly.
Yep. Too bad being friendly hasn't done much for them except to make certain they have to move on every few years.
That was a problem he couldn't solve, Breckenridge mused. He had done some Indian fighting in his life and expected to have to do more before he crossed the divide. But he would just as soon get along with them as much as he could. The two visitors and the group of elders sat on buffalo robes around the fire in the middle of the lodge. Smoke from the crackling, burning wood drifted through the hole in the center of the roof above them. They passed around a pipe. Breckenridge puffed on it when his time came, although he didn't really care for it. When they were done with that, women brought bowls of thick stew that he liked better. While they were eating, Breckenridge asked,
"Are we the first white men who have stopped here this season?"
"Yes," Mahaska replied, "although a group of them camped across the river last night."
"Is that so? How many?"
"Six canoes. Three men in each canoe."
Carnahan's bunch, Breckenridge thought. As if to confirm that, Mahaska went on,
"Their chief was a little man with a long beard, like the ones who dwell underneath the earth."
Breckenridge wasn't sure what he meant by that, but Morgan said, "A dwarf, like the ones in the old folk tales from Europe. As short and wide as Carnahan is, with that beard. I can understand that."
"I do not know what you mean, my friend, but their chief did look like that. You know these men?"
Mahaska's lips pursed a little, as if his future attitude toward Breckenridge and Morgan might depend on their answer.
"We know who they are," Breckenridge said. "Saw them back in St. Louis. They ain't friends of ours."
"This is good. They were very loud. We could hear them all the way across the water."
Mahaska's wrinkled face creased even more in a stern frown.
"They spoke. Ugly things. I was glad that few of my people have an understanding of the white man's tongue. We seek no trouble, but if our young men had known what was being said about our women, they might have wanted to cross the river and fight."
"I'm mighty sorry, Chief. We won't cause you any problems like that."
"No. I can tell that you are decent young men who will not abuse my people. You are welcome to spend the night in the village of the Iowa."
Breckenridge glanced at Morgan. A couple hours of daylight remained. They could get a few more miles upstream if they pushed on after finishing the meal with their hosts. But Breckenridge could tell Morgan wanted to stay. And what difference would a couple of hours make anyway?
"We're obliged to you for the hospitality, Chief," Breckenridge said. "And we'll sure take you up on it."
Chapter 4. Some of the tribes were known to provide visitors with female companionship to warm their robes at night. But the Iowa weren't that hospitable. Actually, Breckenridge was just fine with that development, although he suspected Morgan might have been a tad disappointed. Breck thought it was unlikely that he had sworn off women for good. But right now, he didn't need any of them complicating his life, even temporarily. He and Morgan talked long into the night with Mahaska and the other elders. The chief translated for those who didn't speak English, which was most of them. During the conversation, Mahaska explained that he had learned the language from a black robe, a Jesuit priest, who had come down the Mississippi River from Canada with a party of French trappers some 40 years earlier. The padre had spoken not only French, but also English and Spanish, and had taught all three languages to the young boy, who was eager to learn. In those days, the Iowa had lived far to the east of their current hunting grounds, on the other side of the Great River. Finally, an older woman who Breckenridge figured was one of the chief's wives had led the two white men to one of the smaller lodges. A fire had been built and buffalo robes were laid out around it. Breck and Morgan turned in as the flames burned down to embers. Breckenridge wasn't sure how long he had been asleep when something woke him. As always, he was awake instantly, fully alert, ready for trouble if any threatened. But as he lay there with his eyes open, he didn't hear anything except Morgan's deep, regular breathing on the other side of the fire's faintly glowing remains. He looked around the lodge's dimly lit interior. Nothing was moving or out of place. Breck's rifle, pistols, knife, powder horn, shot pouch, hat, and boots were right beside him. He stiffened as he caught the sound of a quiet cry from somewhere outside. It lasted only a second, and then cut off abruptly, as if someone had clapped a hand over the mouth from which the outcry issued. The sound came from a woman, Breckenridge was sure of that, but it didn't necessarily mean anything. Some wife could have been arguing with her husband. The noise might have even been an outburst of passion, although that wasn't the way it had sounded to Breck. But whatever was going on, it was none of his business, and he was trying to convince himself to roll over and go back to sleep, when a dog suddenly began barking angrily, then yelped and fell silent. That wasn't right, and every instinct in Breckenridge's body told him so. He slid out of the robes and reached for his boots. Without making any noise, he pulled them on and then stood up. He picked up the pistols and the sheathed knife and shoved them behind his belt. Leaving everything else where it was, he went to the entrance and eased aside the deer hide flap that covered the opening. A few desultory barks came from other dogs in the village, but none of them seemed really upset about anything. Maybe he was jumping to conclusions, Breckenridge told himself. Then he heard the brush rustle a little, not far from the lodge he and Morgan shared, which was on the edge of the village away from the river. The growth in that direction was thick. It would be difficult to move through there without making some sort of racket. It would be even harder to do so if you were dragging a prisoner along, Breckenridge thought. Now he was really jumping to conclusions. A muffled cry, a bark, a yelp. Those things didn't add up to a woman being kidnapped. But they didn't rule out the possibility either. Breckenridge knew he had to make sure nothing bad was going on. The Iowa had extended their hospitality to him and Morgan. He owed them that much. He glanced over his shoulder at the vague shape Morgan made under the buffalo robe and thought about waking his friend. Since he wasn't certain about what was going on, he decided to let Morgan sleep. He didn't expect to run into anything he couldn't handle himself. Moving with uncanny stealth for such a big man, Breckenridge drifted out of the lodge and let the flap fall closed behind him. He cat-footed his way to the brush and glided into it. He was good in the darkness and was able to move fairly swiftly without making much noise. Every minute or so, he stopped briefly to listen. The first couple of times he didn't hear anything, but the third time, the crackle of branches again came to his ears, followed by something unmistakable. A curse, grated slowly in a low, guttural voice. It came from a white man, no doubt about that. Another voice hissed what sounded like a command, although Breckenridge couldn't make out the words. He went forward again, moving like a ghost. The village was at least 100 yards behind him now, maybe more. Whomever he was following must have believed they'd put enough distance between themselves and the lodges that they didn't have to be as careful. They started making more noise as they pushed through the brush. Once, Breckenridge heard a soft little cry of pain or fear, or both. But again, it was quickly stifled. 2 men at least, and they had a prisoner. Could some of Carnahan's bunch have doubled back to steal a woman from the Iowa village? That seemed to be the likeliest explanation.
From what Breckenridge had seen of the men, he wouldn't put much of anything past most of them. Too many trappers seemed to regard Indians as less than human. It wouldn't bother them to kidnap an Iowa woman so they could have their sport with her, and then eventually, when they tired of her, killed her or abandoned her in the wilderness. They might even plan on trading her as a slave to some other tribe. Those thoughts filled Breckenridge with fury. He started moving faster in an attempt to catch up. Then, when he stopped to listen again and heard nothing but a somehow ominous silence, he realized he might have made a mistake. The tiny snap of a branch was the only warning he had. He turned as a dark shape hurtled at him from behind. In that split second, he knew the men he was following had heard him, and at least one of them had stopped to lie in wait for him. It was too dark for anything except instinct to guide him. He twisted aside and felt something sharp rake along his side, leaving behind a fiery line of pain. Breckenridge knew he had just been cut by a knife, and whoever was wielding the blade had intended to plunge it into his back. He struck out straight ahead with his right fist, putting all the massive strength of his arm and shoulders into it. The pile driver blow landed solidly against what felt like a man's chest. The unseen attacker grunted and fell back. Breckenridge whipped his own knife from its sheath and slashed the shadows in front of him. The blade bit into flesh. A man loosed a thin cry of pain and then sobbed and cursed.
"He cut me, Harlan,"
the wounded man gasped.
"Get the damn redskin."
So they thought one of the Indians had followed them from the village. Breckenridge didn't see any reason to disabuse them of the notion. He turned and ducked low as footsteps rushed at him from behind. The second man blundered into him and fell right over him. Breck straightened, picking up the man and flinging him away like a rag doll. The man yelled until flying flesh and bone collided with something. A tree trunk by the sound of it. That shut him up in a hurry. Then a third man yelled in pain and exclaimed,
"The bitch bit me!"
A blow thudded. Breckenridge saw red, knowing that the third man had just struck the female captive. He bellowed his rage, since there was no longer any need for stealth, and shoved the knife back in its sheath. Guided by the sounds of a struggle, he charged blindly and hoped he wouldn't bash his brains out against a tree. Instead, he crashed into two wrestling figures. The impact was enough to knock them apart. Breckenridge flailed around until he caught hold of somebody's throat with his left hand. A bristly beard tickled the back of his hand, so he knew he hadn't grabbed the woman. Aiming by that, he swung a huge fist that slammed into the face of the man he grappled with. Breckenridge felt the satisfying crunch of cartilage when the blow landed and knew that he had just flattened the varmint's nose. Maintaining his hold on the man's neck, he bent and grabbed a thigh. With only a slight grunt of effort, he heaved the struggling man into the air, lifted him high, and tossed him into the trees with enough force to break bones.
That ain't an Injun,
a man gasped somewhere nearby.
It's a monster.
Forget about the squaw, another man said. Let's get out of here.
Breckenridge stood there, fists clenched and poised to strike again. But no one else came near him. Instead, he heard the violent rustling of several men fleeing through the brush. From the other direction, back toward the Iowa village, came the sounds of men heading this way to find out what all the shouting was about. When his temper was up, Breckenridge could be a mite loud. Somewhere close by, a woman spoke tentatively in the Iowa tongue. Breckenridge didn't understand but a few words of it and couldn't make out what she was saying. She probably wouldn't understand him either, he thought, but he said,
It's all right now, ma'am. I think them low-down skunks have done took off for the tall and uncut.
She moved closer to him, then took him by surprise by throwing her arms around him and hugging him tightly. Awkwardly, Breckenridge rested a hand on the back of the buckskin dress she wore, and then patted it a couple of times. She began to sob. From the feel of her, she was a little bit of a thing, and didn't quite come up to the middle of his chest. She seemed to be built sturdy, though.
"Here now," Breckenridge said. "It's all right. You ain't got nothing else to be scared of."
Light began to flicker in the woods. Breckenridge looked around and saw that one of the men approaching from the village held a torch. To make sure none of them took him for a kidnapper and launched arrows at him, he called out,
"Chief Mahaska, over here. It's Breckenridge Wallace. Everything's all right."
"Breck!"
That startled exclamation came from Morgan.
"What's going on?"
The red glare from the burning brand fell over Breckenridge and the young Iowa woman who still clung to him. A dozen warriors from the village, along with Morgan and Chief Mahaska, gathered around them. Breck saw the grim faces of the men and the way they held their bows ready with arrows nocked, and was glad he had called out. The woman finally let go of Breckenridge and rushed over to hug Mahaska and chatter at him. Morgan said,
"I knew when there was a commotion and I woke up to find you gone, that you'd be right in the middle of whatever the trouble was, Breck. Then I heard what sounded like a mad bull out here and I was sure of it."
"Some fellow snuck into the village and grabbed that gal," Breckenridge said. "I don't know how many there was. 3 or 4, I reckon. I had a hunch something was up, followed them, and when I knew for certain, I laid into them."
"At odds of 3 or 4 to 1, Morgan said. Breckenridge shrugged.
"You know me, Morgan. When I'm riled up, I never stop to think about things like that."
"And we are very grateful that you do not, friend Breckenridge," Mahaska said.
He turned the still shaken young woman over to some of the other men so they could take her back to the village.
"That is my brother's daughter. Those men intended to treat her very badly."
"No doubt about that. I'm glad I could help," Morgan said.
"Do you figure the bastards came from Carnahan's party?"
"That's the first thing I thought," Breckenridge said. "Some of them could have doubled back easy enough and then caught up to the rest of the bunch later. But I don't know because I never really got a good look at them."
"Whoever they were," Mahaska said, "they will not trouble us again. Not after the punishment you dealt to them."
"I hope that's true," Breckenridge said.
He felt a warm, sticky wetness on his left side and put his hand to it, remembering now that he had been wounded during the fight. It had completely slipped his mind.
"Speaking of punishment, I seem to be bleeding pretty good here."
Chapter 5. The young woman was called Sunflower, and when a smile wreathed her round face, she was as bright and pretty as her namesake. She fussed mightily over Breckenridge when they all got back to the village, and insisted on being the one to clean the knife slash in his side and apply a poultice of herbs to it. He had to take off his shirt for her to do that, of course. And while she was busy with a chore, her hands kept straying up to brush against his broad, muscular chest. On the other side of the fire that had been built up in the lodge, Morgan tried not to grin as he said,
"I've got a hunch you could just stay right here and become a member of the Iowa tribe if you wanted to, Breck. You've got yourself a ready-made wife right there and everything. And let you go on to the mountains by yourself? You wouldn't last a week."
Sunflower said something Breckenridge couldn't make out, but her shy smile and coy, downcast gaze told him she was declaring something along the same lines Morgan had hinted at. The last thing Breckenridge wanted right now was a wife. That feeling had nothing to do with the fact that she was an Indian.
If he'd been in the market for a bride, Sunflower would have made a good one. Since he couldn't think of anything to say, and she wouldn't have understood him anyway, he just sat there in stolid silence while she placed a piece of deer hide over the poultice and tied it in place with several rawhide strips. Breckenridge flexed his left arm, then smiled and nodded at Sunflower. Despite being messy, the wound was...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.